Hello, hello, and welcome back to TGTV, and more specifically, ladies and gentlemen, welcome back to the rather beautiful Ascot Racecourse. I'm here today, once again, with Historix Auctions ahead of their upcoming auction this Saturday. I'm going to have a little look around the lots, and I've also found something which I'm actively going to bid on this weekend. No clickbait, it's my actual intention to bid on this specific car. So, head up with me here, and if you fancy having a little look around here, like I'm doing right now, you can come and check the place out this week. All their opening hours are available on historix.co.uk. Now, as always with Historix Auctions, there's so many lots. I can't get round all of them. And bear in mind, the cars are still being loaded up. I'm here well ahead of time. I'm actually here on Tuesday. This is a Tuesday I'm filming, so not everything is here. We've got some project cars, some really cool stuff. That's mega. That's actually Targa convertible chaos. Right, let's come through here then, because as always I found some stuff that I want to show you guys. There are a lot of SLs in the auction this weekend, so make sure you're an SL fan, you have a little look through. Right, this I wanted to highlight, this because if you ever wanted to build your own Countach, this is available as pretty much everything you need. Countach flat pack, if you like, that is in the auction. All details are on site. That is mega. Green. Your eyes are not deceiving you. That is green with crema. Beautiful, beautiful spec. Split wheels. Love that. At some point, I do want to add one of these to the garage. This also has caught my eye. Beautiful, beautiful. And this one is a manual. Right-hand drive, manual. Daytona seats in there. I don't think you can really argue with that, to be honest with you. This is on my shopping list. One of these is on my shopping list, but I'm not going to bid this weekend on this. Again, all details on that car, all details on that green car are on site. So, as always, I make a beeline for Porsches. We've got a Carrera Sport there with the kind of the full sport package on it. We've also got this 356, which is chaos. All details on this car, as I say, are on the website. So I'm not going to bore on and on and on about it. But yes, perfect, perfect little racing car. That is in beautiful condition, beautifully restored. Basically a historic racing car, lovely. Anyway, another SL. And a car actually that's in a lot of people's talking space at the moment is the Porsche 928. Having just seen the Risky Business 928 going for $2 million in a US auction recently, 928s have suddenly become the topic of everyone's conversation. There's a green one here with cream inside, automatic. That is a very nice 928S. They are actually wicked. You know what I love about 928s? It's this window here. It's just mayhem. This whole rear quarter window here, and the back end with the wing. It's mega. Love this. Anyway, all details, of course, on site. How about that? Not just sports cars either. I think that's a bowler. Potentially, is that a bowler? I mean, it's mayhem, whatever it is. Fantastic. Cannot argue one of these. Right-hand drive, manual box, 348. Wallop. These are looking better by the day, and undervalued, I think, 348s. I've said it before on this channel. There's literally something for everyone here. We've got Mustang as well. Havoc. Proper. That is proper. Also on the potential shopping list one day is one of these. I think they're absolutely stunning. Absolutely love an E-Type V12 wallop. Another SL, I told you there's a few here. And also on the, I mean, my shopping list is complete hell, as I'm sure you probably would suspect would be the case, but 190 SL is very definitely on the hit list. I just think it's inarguable. 300 SLs have completely evaded my capture. They're completely out of price range, and I suspect they will be forever. So 190 SL, it might have to be. That is available to come and view ahead of this weekend's auction. I love a 190 SL. That is genuinely a beautiful, beautiful car. We've got some sultry music to accompany it as well. Anyway, we've got all sorts here. I can't go through every single lot, although I am actually attempting to at this point. We've got some projects here as well for those that are a little bit more hands-on. Another SL in green. That is a really nice colourway, actually. Green and tan. Argue with that, I dare you. Rollers, Aston, Corvette. Ooh, I've seen another Porsche, everyone. I've seen another Porsche. 996 Turbo. Another SL. Manual 996 Turbo, 65,000 miles. Again, inarguable. You would struggle to argue with that. This is really special. I can't actually remember the exact details on it, but I think it's a roof. Well, yeah, it is actually. Clues on the front there, Tom. I remember looking at this and feeling a little wibble when I was reading through the details. That is sensational. Anyway. Guys, if you've seen anything that's tickled your pickle there, then get over to Historic's website and get clicking on all the details for each car. And also, each car will actually have its own little video. I mean, that is mayhem. That's chaos. Each car will have its own little video on the Historic's Auctions YouTube channel. So if you want further details or a little walk around of it before you come and have a little look here, then head over to their channel. And I will also be cameoing on their channel as well. I'll be featuring on there with none other than VBH, Vicky Butler Henderson, and also Matthew here, who consigns all the cars in and is a font of all things cars. So without further waffle then, I'm gonna head all the way back down to the end of the race course to jump in the Alfa Romeo and let's go for a spin. I cannot wait to get in this car. It's a car that I've ogled at literally since I was, what, 8? I'm not gonna carbon date myself. But yes, I'm very excited. Me and my brother loved these when we were kids. It's been on the bucket list to drive and I can't wait, so let's go. So here we go then. This is actually lot number 176, a 1992 Alfa Romeo SZ Coupe. It is a UK supplied and UK registered car, one of only 1,036 units built worldwide, and it was actually hand built by none other than Zagato. SZ actually stands for Sprint Zagato, or the other name for this car was the ES30, which actually meant experimental sports car 3 litre. It actually earned the nickname Il Mostro, translated meaning the monster, and from the first sketch to its unveiling at the Geneva Motor Show in March 1989, it took only 19 months for this car to reach production and be built. Designed by a chap called Walter De Silva, who was later to design Alfa Romeo's very successful 156, which I'm sure most of you remember, the SZ was based on the Alfa Romeo 75 3-litre. Walter worked in conjunction with Zagato and actually came up with this aggressive and brutal design, resulting in the Il Mostro that you see in front of you here. It is just ridiculous. The proportions on this car are unlike anything you see today. Even the fact that the back wheel is pretty much on the back corner there. The front is so low and there's just so much wraparound around the wheels. And just the way the back of the car just stops like that, the proportions are absolutely mental. The front end of this car is just so, so iconic. As a kid, I grew up looking at these things. Whenever I saw them, I remember me and my brother used to go absolutely bonkers. And oh, not a bad cameo. There is a video on the Historic's Auctions YouTube channel driving with that DB5 and this with Vicky Butler Henderson behind the wheel and Matthew Pretty here as well. So that front end then, let's start here because this is where the story starts and why this car is so iconic. These triple kind of split headlights, this aggressive grille, and the fact that this Alfa sort of hole here doesn't even have the logo in it like a lot of Alphas usually do. It doesn't, it just lets air through the front and you've got the badge up here instead. The front of this car is just so iconic, and that iconic triangle continues up through the middle here into this vented portion up into the windscreen. It's just mega. I absolutely adore this car. It's not just pretty either, it is also clever. The structure of this car is very, very smart. It was actually a bit of a collab between Zagato, Fiat, and Alfa Romeo. The body is actually composite and the roof structure is aluminium, resulting in a lightweight but very strong design. This car actually spent a lot of time in Fiat's wind tunnel of all places, and the engineers actually managed to get the drag factor of the front end down to 0.30. now, I don't know what that actually means. I don't know if that's good, but presumably because it's been written down and celebrated about this car, that probably is a good thing. It still though did achieve real downforce, aided hugely with this wing here, which is pretty ludicrous and also just such an iconic part of this car's design. And why I'm going to have such a laugh driving this thing is because there's no driver aid. It doesn't even have the ABS, which is chaos. The cornering ability of this car has actually been celebrated for decades and decades because of its weight distribution. Apparently it is 50-50 over each set of wheels. Let's find out anyway. Let's get it fired up and let's go for a spin.
Right, let's go then. Let's go, let's hit the road. Get fired up. Always fun with older cars. Always fun. All right, let's get a move on then. Let's get out of the race course and go and find some open roads. I'm actually genuinely buzzing to drive this thing. Genuinely buzzing. I've ogled these cars for years and years and years, and they're just so niche. You don't ever see them. It's estimated that there are less than 100 of these left remaining in the UK. I suspect it's quite a lot less than that. Most of these were optioned in red, but there are a few yellow ones that I've seen around, and there's also a black one or two that I've seen knocking around the place. So we'll just get out of the race course now. They're in the service area. Maybe the first and last time an SZ Coupe has been in the service area of Ascot Racecourse. Now this has been moved a bit before I got in it, so it is a little bit warm. One thing I'd say with this car, if you're a shrinking violet, don't get one of these. Everybody looks at it, absolutely everybody. No one can really work out what it is and why they've never seen one before. They kind of have a second look. They're trying to work out what it is. Driving position then, I do feel quite sat upright. Pedals seem a bit difficult to do a bit of heel and toe. The pedals are quite far over to the right-hand wall and the steering wheel does kind of interfere a little bit. It's not quite Porsche driving position-wise, but it's an Alfa Romeo. You're expecting quirks, you're expecting slight flaws. And to be honest with you, I'm half expecting there to be some sort of mechanical issue on this drive. It's just par for the course with these cars. Let's hope not though, eh? Here we go, first to second. So this car is powered by a 3-litre 12-valve engine with a 5-speed manual box, punting out 207 brake horsepower from new. It is rear-wheel drive, and as I mentioned earlier, the weight distribution is actually 50-50 over each axle. And at one point it was said that of all production cars out at that time, you could generate the most lateral G's in one of these cornering than any other road car while still keeping it on the road. Now, I don't know how true that actually is, and sure as hell, I'm not gonna test that today. If I do, something's gone wrong. But it does feel very nimble. Now, this particular car has done 31,411 miles. So since 1992, that is not a huge amount of use. It has been fastidiously cared for. It's got extensive service history, and this car is actually number 421 and also comes with the rare option of the 050 speedometer, which I've read and I still can't work out what that means. All I know is that there's very nice carbon fiber, almost F40-esque instruments in front of you here. It's also optioned with a beige interior and these bucket seats. It's left-hand drive, which indeed all of these cars were, and there's some really nice little Zagato details. You've got Zagato design on the steering wheel here, and you've also got Zagato design on the headrest of these amazing kind of beige bucket seats here. It's surprisingly comfortable as well. I expected it to be a bit rattly, a bit horrible, but it's actually really nice. All that said, I actually don't want any of you to even like this car. I don't want you to want to buy this car. I don't want you thinking this car is good. I actually want you to dislike it. I want you to hate it. That is because I want to bid on this car and I don't want any of you bidding on it. I genuinely mean that. This isn't reverse psychology. I'm not telling you, oh, don't go and bid on it, hey. I'm saying please don't. I want to bid on this car, I want to be left alone, and I want to purchase this car. I've just, do you know what? It's a car that I've kind of, every now and again, I've gone onto Auto Trader, I've gone onto Classic Driver, whatever it is, and I've had a little look at these to see what they're doing values-wise. The values have crept up on them. Indeed, I remember a day where they were kind of like 20-odd grand. That is not the case anymore. The estimate on this car is 40K, which, okay, yeah, it's a lot of money, but it's not a huge amount of money considering this is a really cool piece of Alfa Romeo history, and personally a car that I had as a background on my dad's computer when I was a child. I'm trying to work out how old I actually was when I actually was kind of into these things. They started production in 1989 and they ended production in the early 90s. This being a 1992 car, it seems like it should be a relatively late one, although number 421, I don't know what they were doing in Italy. Maybe that's just a random badge they stick on. It should be towards the end of the production run, 3 years in, but I don't know. Anyway, I must have been, by the time that these were all on the road and kind of doing the rounds, a few years into them all kind of being out and about, I must have been, dunno, 6, 7, 8, a young lad anyway, a young whippersnapper along with JE. I'm really interested to know how well this car does online. I'm interested to see who out there actually cares about this car, who knows about it, who cares about it, and who actually thinks, TG, you're rabbiting on about another piece of junk. Why are you so excited about junk these days? I think this would look cool in the garage though. I think this alongside my Testarossa would be wicked. They're pretty much same era cars, you know, late 80s, early 90s. And I think they represent an era of Italian cars which just won't be replicated again. We are now into the era of hyper Hoovers and frankly, just absurd rubbish that does 0 to 60 quicker than you can fart. It's just getting silly, emotionless, and frankly, actually quite dangerous. Speaking of dangerous then, as I said earlier, this thing doesn't have ABS. It doesn't have power steering. It doesn't have traction control. It's got nothing. Now, traction control probably isn't too much of an issue as it is only 207 brake horsepower from new. So I suspect probably only about 190 something by now with a degradation of engines and whatnot. But it feels very involving, it feels very visceral, and the cornering ability you can feel, albeit I'm not pushing it around here, A, this isn't my car, and B, these are kind of public roads around Ascot Racecourse. You can feel that kind of bite in there from Il Mostro. So, fingers crossed for this weekend. I'm gonna bring it in now before I do it some harm, or someone does it some harm. I want it back in one piece because I want to bid on it. They say don't meet your heroes, but I say why not? Meet all of them, meet the lot. I've driven an F40 now, I've driven a Zagato, I've driven an RS2 recently. Things are going well at the moment on the channel. They're not going well views-wise, but they're going well enjoyment-wise. Sod it, sod whether anyone else likes it. I'm having fun, that's the main thing. So, running costs, concerns, Alfa Romeo. They are not known as the most reliable cars on the planet, and will this thing, you know, God forbid I win it, will this thing ruin my life? On the whole, these are generally considered to be relatively reliable. The running costs aren't scary. There's loads of really good Alfa specialists out there. The only thing that does potentially cause me some sort of element of anxiety and stress is you've got two buttons here on this center console. Actually inlaid in carbon all around the gear knob, brilliant. However, you've got two buttons here. One with a little red suspension mark and one with a little green suspension mark. That is to tighten and soften the suspension depending on your use for that day. A really, really cool feature and something that a lot of modern cars actually have these days and you wouldn't bat an eyelid at. But 1989 level of tech, softening your dampers and hardening up your dampers, I have no faith in those still working. Indeed, I haven't even tested them out because frankly, I don't want to know. I just want to bid and then sort it out another time. I have heard reports that it does work relatively well and it's quite a cool feature. But yeah, it remains to be seen. Thank you, sir. That bloke is absolutely sick of me. So yeah, but other than that, there's not really anything to go wrong. You've got some very basic fans and aircon and whatnot. The head unit in here, I mean, you can just replace that anyway, and I'd redo the audio in here anyway. Everything seems to be working though. The fuel gauge, must be working because we're still moving. The temperature gauge is right in the middle there. You've got your oil, which is, you know, just below half, which is great. The battery monitor is just below half. You know, the clock's even telling the right time. So all in all, it's good. There's a slight sort of rattling noise from the back, which I suspect is like a loose clip or something like that. You know, all the serious stuff is in the front. I'm not that worried by this thing. I'm really not that worried. Let's bring her in then. Let's bring her in. Hopefully you enjoyed that little drive down memory lane, actually, for me, and a drive through the service quarters of Ascot Racecourse. Hope you enjoyed that video. Anyway, hopefully you, I don't know if you learned something, or maybe it just revived cool memories of a car that time seems to have forgotten. Anyway, wish me luck on the bidding. As I said before, please don't even think about bidding on this one. You're more than welcome to bid on all the other cars available this weekend. But for now, thank you very much for watching. Do subscribe, blah, blah, blah. Huge thank you to Historic Auctions as always. And make sure you check out their podcast as well, featuring myself, Matthew from Historics, and Vicky Butler Henderson. That is available on all streaming platforms and also available to actually watch on their YouTube channel as well. Each car in the auction has its own video as well. So I've done a terrible job walking around the lots in there, but the guys here do a much better job than that. So make sure you go and check it out. Anyway, for now, thank you very much. Hope you're all well. See you soon. Bye.